welcome to Dr. Matt Spalding.
We ain't gonna stop now until we get that freedom.
Wow, great. Great to be with you. Good afternoon. This is a great conference. When Jennifer asked me to do the wrap-up, I, of course, dutifully agreed before I had any idea what I was going to talk about. And we've had some great speakers, so I threw out all my notes and started over again. Wasn't Ben Sasse great? And Carly Fiener on the American idea, the most important thing, they get it. They get it. But my friends, we're in some difficult times. So Hillsdale College is an old college. It was founded in 1844, long before accreditation, all this nonsense about higher education in Hillsdale, Michigan. And we teach a bunch of old things about the true, the good, and the beautiful. It was formed by some men grateful to God for the blessings of civil and religious liberty to provide education to all, regardless of their race, regardless of their sex, or their creed, so to perpetuate civil and religious liberty. Hillsdale is also an abolitionist college. When Civil War broke out in 1861, we had a crisis because all the men of the college left to fight. Indeed, our college, as a proportion of the student body, put more men into the Civil War than any other college in the country. If you go to Gettysburg, there are markers in several important places to the Michigan regiments that fought. It turns out that if you want to perpetuate the truth of liberty, you must sometimes fight for it. So I'm based in Washington, D.C., where I try to fight for those principles behind enemy lines, as I say. Remind those who are involved in politics about the meaning of politics. There are a lot of beautiful things in Washington, D.C., but a lot of ugly things as well. When people come to visit, I like to talk about architecture. It's a great rule of thumb. It's pretty easy to guess as you drive down a street in the nation's capital where the unconstitutional things are, because they tend to be in the most ugly buildings. See, the modern buildings are designed for desks and clerks, for bureaucracies, from which we get the word, the rule of desks, bureaus. But the beautiful buildings are the ones where the very grandeur of the design points to what goes on inside them. The United States Capitol, Supreme Court building, and the National Archives, at least until the Department of Homeland Security got a hold of them, had one thing in common. And you recall from visiting, all of them required to walk up stairs from the outside and look up. I note as a footnote that the human animal of all of God's great creation is the only one who has enough vertebrae to look up above the horizon. So those buildings were designed to force man to look up to the grandeur of the American democratic project. My favorite of those buildings is the National Archives building. Massive facade and columns, brass doors, central rotunda. It's designed in the style of the Roman pantheon. You see, the temples of the ancient world were grand monuments constructed to provide sacrifices to pagan gods. The pantheon was the greatest. The temple of all the gods, where the victorious Romans kept their conquered deities. The difference between these two structures, the Roman pantheon and the National Archives, can't be more striking. At the entrance of the Pantheon, famously the statues of Caesar and Agrippa, his military general. The reigning emperor was enthroned inside, wielding power at the center of the world. In the rotunda of the National Archives, there are no statues of dead rulers, no symbols of power, no emblems of military glory, but merely in its center on a simple marble altar, two faded documents. You've heard the argument. Every nation derives its meaning from some purpose. Ethnic character, a common heritage, religion, shared history, but this country is different. It's unique because it's based on a particular idea. It asserts truths which we say are self-evident, according to the laws of nature and nature's God. In working for those principles of human equality, we launched an experiment in popular government, claimed a new basis for political legitimacy. Consent to the governed, through a carefully written constitution, created an enduring framework of limited government based on the rule of law. Our revolution was about ideas based for a new nation that were permanent truths, as Lincoln said, applicable to all men in all times. To this day, the American Revolution, its principles, define and inspire us, serving not only as a powerful beacon to those throughout the world who strive for freedom, but a warning to tyrants and despots everywhere. The question today, it seems to me, the same question in the Civil War, the same question the founders initially asked, can a nation so conceived long endure? I sometimes wonder, what would the founders think if they came back today? They would see a nation that's won its independence, established a government and a sovereign nation, completed its continental expansion and brought unparalleled prosperity to its citizens. It survived a devastating civil war that threatened its very life. It abolished slavery and raised the emancipated to be citizens equal to their one-time masters. It triumphed in two world wars, fought on foreign soil, and a decades-long struggle against worldwide communism. They would see before them a country greater than they could have ever imagined by any measure. Its economy is a quarter of the world's annual domestic product. Its military allows it to exert its force anywhere in the globe. Its people remain one of the most hardworking, church-going, affluent, and generous in the world. Just as George Washington hoped in his farewell address, we have become a nation in command of its own fortunes. And yet it seems we are in the course of self-destruction. What advice would they give us? For sure, they'll be deeply concerned about our culture. The purpose of limited government, after all, was to allow a flourishing of civil society, those mediating institutions that Tocqueville talked about, that Ben Sass referred to, private associations like the Rotary Club, schools, colleges, churches especially. But my friends, those institutions are not simply fading away. They are under assault by a political agenda that increasingly has the power of government and the courts at its back. The founders would be especially concerned, I believe, about the family, about those pre-political institutions of moms and dads and children that they called, taking a phrase from Cicero, the seminary of the republic. When a government fails to recognize when a child is a child and when a marriage is a marriage, something has gone awry. America's principles define the nature of our national identity, but that identity can be sustained only by citizens of firm convictions and sound character. And from the beginning, America's creed and culture developed together, nourishing each other for the common good. But by assuming more tasks in more and more areas outside its responsibilities, government has caused great damage to our country. Entitlement mentality, dependency, rather than self-reliance and independence, encourages a character incompatible with republicanism. The extended reach of the state, fueled by its imperative to impose moral neutrality in the public square, continues to push those institutions in the shadows of public life, undermining respect for the institutions necessary for civil society. Redefining them now with the full authority and force of the federal government. The immediate grave problem we face, the founders I think would observe, is political. A national government once limited to its core functions has all but unquestioned dominance in virtually every area of American life. Restricted only by expediency, political will, and less, budget constraints. Congress passes massive pieces of legislation with little serious deliberation. It's increasingly an administrative body overseeing a vast array of bureaucratic policymakers and rulemaking bodies. Although the Constitution vests legislative power in Congress, the majority of laws, in quotation marks, what passes for laws, what in all intents and purposes are laws, all promulgated by administrative agencies. Congress, on average, passes about 200 to 250 laws each year. There are somewhere between 5 and 8,000 regulations a year. The founders like to say that here, the people rule. I'm not so sure they would see it that way. Federal and state courts, meanwhile, don't adjudicate the law as much as they rewrite it, sometimes make it up, usurping the power of political branches. All the important questions in America today, virtually every question of public policy, is subject to judges. We're covered by an intricate web of government policies and procedures. Locals, states, localities, private institutions, all still exist, but subsumed under national programs. And now, as Congress has expanded the bureaucracy, creating innumerable agencies, delegating its lawmaking authority, losing control of the details of its budget, the executive has grown to new levels of authority, like never before. The executive can direct the bureaucracy using his pen and phone through discretion, poorly written laws, and a neglect of the law. If that's established, accepted, the president can govern without Congress, without the law, it will prove very difficult to turn that around. This view of America that dominates the academy, the journalism, major foundations, most segments of American intellectual life, most portions of political leadership, was marked out last century by progressive thinkers we've discussed. They repudiated the founders' principles, holding there were no self-evident truths in the Declaration of Independence or elsewhere, but only constant change, progress without final goals. Our fidelity must be to a living constitution that adapts and changes with time. These principles have been assaulted, undermined, and redefined in our culture, in our universities, and in our politics. Tocqueville, who we praise for his praise of associations, little platoons, warned of this possibility of a new and soft despotism that destroys the human spirit. My friends, I believe today we are in a crisis, a fundamental regime question. And what rules us, this thing we call bureaucracy, is indeed a new form of government. Not merely inefficient, though it is, but a way of rule. And it's transformed everything. Congress, the presidency, the judiciary. We're being ruled by a national equivalent of the DMV. And more people, every poll tells us, fear government. It's increasingly despotic. It's an existential threat to self-government. And that thing won't go away. You can't ignore it. And it must be defeated. We approach a time of choosing, and it's a political choice. Our politics are divided, increasingly divisive, coming to a head. But But that's been brewing for some time. You see, Congress created this problem. Democratic Congresses. Although Republicans contributed to this as well. Until recently, it was really not recognized as a problem. Although you can go back, read Ronald Reagan's famous speech in 1964 called A Time for Choosing, where he attacks this idea of being ruled by bureaucrats. Things continued and went on, and now it's a fundamental problem. Political leaders in the Republican Party didn't absorb what was a great opportunity we had in what was called the Tea Party. And so we have a growing divide. And the result should be no surprise. A popular insurgency breaking up party alignments. Love him or hate him, or both. The Republican nominee, Mr. Trump, broke through all this in a way that innumerable, extremely talented other candidates could not. And he addressed some issues that the American people were very worried about at the center of this problem of bureaucratic rule. As much as we hate Washington, D.C. and hate politics, especially this current election, I think the founders would be quick to remind us that politics matters. It always matters. And if you're not interested in politics, politics is interested in you. It matters who controls the presidency. It matters who controls Congress. It matters who makes the laws. It matters who executes them. It matters who appoints judges and confirms them. We live at a time of an increasingly unbalanced relationship in the structure of our government. The founders would be quick to see that. They wrote a constitution not as a mere parchment. They always remind us it's about structure, checks and balances, the separation of powers. Today we have an extremely weak Congress, feckless. It does virtually nothing. It's not a player. An increasingly growing executive bureaucratic role threatening to overwhelm our society. Congress needs to reestablish its powers within the constitutional system, especially getting control of the budget. The executive needs to rule according to the rule of law and is willing to challenge the bureaucracy. And I can tell you that any Republican president will be forced to confront the bureaucracy. Even a strong executive will need Congress to do its job and rein in the bureaucratic state. If you know what it'll look like, Paul Ryan has written a great constitutional agenda. I helped him write it. The best chance we have of restoring the balance in our government is to revive the founder's system of checks and balances and the separation of power. Ryan's agenda is Mr. Trump's political solution. I wonder sometimes what the founders would think about how we think about politics. Our thinking has become often stiff and ideological. Most Americans don't think in ideological terms like conservatism or progressivism even. And yet we talk about purists who want everything perfect or pragmatists who go along to get along. One or the other, you can't have both. Can't be principled and practical at the same time. Think about how we talk about the Constitution, often in legalistic and technical terms. No wonder most Americans think the Constitution is a jumble of legalisms for lawyers. We need to talk to them in the way that they understand, in the terms of citizenship. The founders' world is a world of politics and principles. Politics were to be guided by fundamental truths, not out of thin air some evolving arc of history. It's progressivism that rejects those truths. We need to renew them. Not as a matter of historical curiosity, but a source of direction. Not looking back to the 18th century and not making formulaic appeals to those principles. Because principles, you see, don't answer all of our questions. They merely give us the moorings, the North Star. Tell us where we're going. We navigate according to prudence, That term has a bad name today. But I remind you, it's one of the cardinal virtues, essential to all the other virtues. We must be firm in our principles so that we can be prudent in our politics. Washington's military strategy, if you recall from my seminar the other day, was very simple. Retreat, 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 and then attack. Win was a prudent decision. James Madison hated the idea of a Bill of Rights. He opposed it at the convention. He went down fighting against it every chance he had. But when it was necessary politically to pass the Constitution, what did he do? Prudently. He wrote the Bill of Rights. The Constitution is said to be a bundle of compromises because of slavery. But if you read those clauses, they're carefully written to undermine slavery over time. Abolitionists, the radical abolitionists, hated Abraham Lincoln. His objective was to save the Union first. He hated slavery, but he freed them too. Winston Churchill once defended himself from the charge of inconsistency. He changed political parties not once, not twice, but three times. A silly inconsistency, he said, is a hobgoblin of small minds. We must adjust and tack and move, but we must do so with the same dominant purpose. The job of the statesman, of the politician, properly understanding the term, is to understand principle and apply them to particular circumstances. Politics matter, the founders would say, and you must be prudent. And there's a cause for prudence in this election. This candidate was my first choice, wasn't my second choice, wasn't my third choice, need I go on? But one of the two dominant people in this election will be the next president of the United States. I don't know what's going to happen. But I can tell you, prudence is not about easy decisions, but hard decisions. Harder in the midst of a fight. Abraham Lincoln said that in a war, you don't win by blowing rose water through corn stalks. It's not about particular personalities or candidates, but we are in a battle to determine the fate of free government. I fear for my country when I contemplate a new, consolidated, aggressive, progressive agenda under one party controlling three branches of the federal government. You should too. Politics matters, my friends, and sometimes you have to fight. Prudence also dictates we refocus on what we hold in common. Did you know that the current Republican platform, not the current one, but the one in 2012, was 33,000 words long, 65 pages. How many people read it? Anybody? People don't read it. Lays off, you're an oddball. The platform of 1860, upon which Abraham Lincoln ran, was a page and a half, 1,200 words. Succinct statements of principle meant to be read by the American people. So this year, a few of us at Hillsdale College wrote a platform, modeled on the 1860 one. We should know something about that because the early draft of Lincoln's platform was written at our college. A clear statement of principle about the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. A few policy particulars. The federal government has become too centralized and many powers should be checked and returned to the states. The American people have full right to decide who joins them in citizenship. The military is to be strong in defense of our nation and its interests. War should be undertaken cautiously, but when undertaken, it should be fought fiercely with utmost speed. There's wide agreement on the common things. One can find general agreement in the likes of Paul Ryan, Mitch McConnell, Mike Lee, and Tom Cotton, Mitt Romney, and Ben Sasse. For all the perceived division in our party, in the Republicans, and within conservatism, the ground is laid for an agreement on core principles and a few policies to implement them. But we must go back to principles, the founders would argue, and make practice consistent with those. Last, I think they would remind us about the most important things. We should never forget or confuse the higher ends of human life. I'm sometimes asked why Jefferson substituted in the Declaration of Independence for the locking term, pursuit, life, liberty, and property. He wrote, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Happiness is a classical term, the end of politics, about the virtue and the good. And pursuit is about pursuing those ends. It's always reminded me of that old Latin term, status viatoris. Man is the only being who's in the state of being on his way. It's a pilgrimage to know the truth about things, about man, about nature, and about his creator. That's our end. They would also remind us of human nature, as others have pointed out. There's something about it. Every time it gets kicked out, it comes back in with a vengeance. It yearns to be free, not to be enslaved. Winston Churchill once observed that people are easy to lead, but they're hard to drive. Therein lies our best hope. To succeed, the progressive project needs to use the full force of the state to break the American spirit. And this, I believe, they will fail. This battle is far from over, my friends. In many ways, it's just begun. We should look for opportunities, good ones, bad ones, whatever we can find, to drive towards that objective. After the battles of Lexington and Concord, when the American colonists chased the British back to Boston, those revolutionaries took a meager position on Charleston Peninsula, overlooking Boston Harbor, and took up a spot on Breed's Hill. The British, who were established in Boston, contemptuous of the rabble in arms, they called them, decided to attack their position. The person in charge of the Americans was named Joseph Warren, head of the Public Safety Committee. Twice the British regulars attacked them. Twice the Americans held their fire to the very end. You might recall the famous line from that battle, "Don't fire until you see the whites of their eyes." That's because they were short ammunition and had no reinforcements. The Americans were overwhelmed eventually in the third attack. The British swarmed the redoubt, stabbing with their bayonets, and only later did they find Joseph Warren in a trench below the bodies of his fellow patriots. Before he died, Warren gave a famous speech. "Our streets are filled with armed men," he said. "Our harbor is crowded with ships of war. But these cannot intimidate us. Our liberty must be preserved. It is far dearer than life. No longer could we reflect with generous pride on the heroic actions of our American forefathers if we but for a moment would entertain the thought of giving up on liberty. Our country is in danger, but not to be despaired of. Our enemies are numerous and powerful. but we have friends determining to be free, and heaven and earth will aid in the resolution. On you, he said, on you depend the fortunes of America. You are to decide the important question on which rests the happiness and liberty of millions yet unborn. Act worthy of yourselves. The American idea is an experiment, and it always will be. It will be tested again and again and again. That's the human condition. There are no permanent victories, at least not in this life. So, my friends, roll up your sleeves. Go out there and fight as if the life of your country depended on it. There are many fights to be had, large and small, many to be won and lost, as God has given you talents to fit for the task. But one thing is absolutely clear. You can go forth confidently. No, you should go forth joyfully, knowing with complete conviction the rightness of the cause, not because of some old, faded documents in a building, in a city, but because of the truths we hold. As a young Alexander Hamilton wrote on the eve of war in 1774, the truths we hold are written as with a sunbeam in the whole volume of human nature by the hand of the divinity itself. Act worthy.